is. Nothing feels better than it. Nothing feels better. Nothing feels better than it.
That was Khalid with Better. Welcome to the Rise Weekly Review for November 30th through December 6th, 2020. Our top story involves a 21-year-old Hammond man who was found dead near the harbor in East Chicago on Sunday. The man, identified as Angel Castaneda, was found dead near the 3600 block of Grand Boulevard in the afternoon. He was found with a gunshot wound to the head in the grass outside the East Chicago Academy of Visual and Performing Arts. Police did not receive any calls of gunshots in the areas, nor did the shot spotter detect any shootings in the area. Anyone with information is asked to contact Detective Acevedo at 219-391-8318 or leave an anonymous tip at 219-391-8500. On Thursday, a 24-year-old man was found with multiple gunshot wounds in Hammond. Around 1:40 a.m., police responded to a shooting on the 4100 block of Wabash Avenue when they found a man with multiple gunshot wounds in a vehicle's driver's seat. The man was found with gunshot wounds in his head, arm, and chest. He was sent to an area hospital where he was reported in critical condition. He was later airlifted to a Chicago hospital where his condition was eventually stabilized. Anyone with information is asked to contact Detectives Bates or Clark at 219-852-2979 or 219-852-2987. A man was shot on Tuesday in South Shore while confronting a robber. The 21-year-old man was walking near the 7800 block of Cornell Avenue when someone attempted to rob him. According to police, someone flashed a gun at the man and announced the robbery. The man attempted to knock the gun away when the person opened fire. The man was struck in the hand and went to Jackson Park Hospital. He was last reported in good condition. Anyone with information is asked to contact Chicago Police or leave a tip at cpdtip.com. In a second South Shore shooting over the weekend, a 41-year-old was shot in the leg and chest. According to police, the man was arguing with the man outside a building located on the 7700 block of South Luella around 2:10 a.m. in the late hours of Friday, early Saturday. He was transported to the University of Chicago Hospital in critical condition. Anyone with information is asked to contact Chicago Police or leave a tip at cpdtip.com. In other Northwest Indiana news, three men and a woman were sentenced on Friday for their involvement in the burglary and gang rape of a woman in Hammond in 2018. The three men, Elias Costello, age 20, of East Chicago, Nathaniel Asbury, age 23, of Hammond, and Isaiah Barbosa, age 18, were each sentenced to 60 years. The woman, 22-year-old Alexis Leitz of Antioch, Illinois, was sentenced to 23 years. The men were convicted of coordinating with Leitz on the robbery on July 18, 2018, of a relative's home she once lived with her family. Leitz, who drove the men to the crime scene, provided the co-defendants with a detailed map of the home, including locations of cameras, jewelry, and safes where valuables were stored. A 19-year-old relative of Leitz was sleeping on the couch when the men entered the home using a key Leitz provided them. The men, armed with a shotgun, raped the young woman. The woman's 16-year-old brother, who locked himself in a room after being threatened, alerted his mother, who contacted police and activated surveillance equipment. Police arrived 22 minutes after the assault began and arrested the defendants. Former 10th Ward Alderman Edward Verdoliak was sentenced during the week as well. As reported last week, Verdoliak was indicted and pled guilty on charges stemming from corruption in a tax case involving a settlement with tobacco companies in the 1990s. Verdoliak reportedly made $12 million off the litigation without being involved in the work. He was charged with a tax crime that alleged he obstructed the IRS investigation into payments to and from his co-defendant, Daniel Soso. Soso, a former Chicago cop, pled guilty to one count of tax evasion for failing to report $3 million in income related to the deal. His lawyers argued the 82-year-old suffers from a brain tumor and other health problems and should be sentenced to probation or home confinement. However, the judge instead sentenced Verdoliak to 18 months in prison. The judge reportedly commented on Verdoliak's history of breaking the law. He was quoted as saying, "This was a particularly sorry story because this is two experienced lawyers who were involved in this crime." And he also stated, "In a sense, the fact that we're doing this with the defendant who is 82 years old is in many ways his own doing." In other news, during the week, the Chicago Tribune posted a story about the Hegwisch Coal Hills, or what the article refers to as the Shroud Superfund site. The site was purchased by a developer named Daniel Shroud in 1994, who planned to build an industrial park and sports complex. Shroud, who was connected to former Mayor Richard Daley and Alderman John Burke, purchased the site for $50,000. Burke, who was working as Shroud's personal tax attorney at the time, used his aldermanic power to name the area a special taxing district to provide funding to clean up, rebuild roads, and sewers on the site. In 2000, Shroud sold the property for $4.2 million, leaving the site without ever handling the old waste on the site. Despite its name, the site does not contain coal but is full of slag, which is a waste produced by the steel industry. The site is known to be contaminated with high levels of lead, chromium, and other inorganic compounds. The site was designated as a Superfund site by the federal EPA. Superfund sites are designations used by the EPA to mark the most highly contaminated sites in the nation and designate them for taxpayer-funded cleanup. During the week, the city announced a public meeting on November 10th at 6 p.m. to allow Southeast Side residents a chance to comment on the final permit for the RMG expansion that will bring a new car shredding facility to the old Republic Steel site. The facility, once called General Iron when it was located in Lincoln Park, was purchased by RMG. RMG has settled a number of city health and environmental violations by General Iron that occurred before its purchase. However, even after its purchase, the site has been cited for several violations, including during an explosion in May. The site is supposed to open across from the East Side Plaza in George Washington High School near Avenue O. The city opened a public comment period which will run through December 30th to allow residents to submit comments on the process. These can be submitted to nfcomments@cityofchicago.org. The city has also posted RMG's permit application. Public health officials have to allow a public comment period before issuing a permit. It is unclear when the city plans to provide the permit. HUD has asked the city to hold off on the permit pending a federal investigation as part of a civil rights complaint. Lawyers for the Lightfoot Administration dismissed concerns about pollution from the site as unfounded and accused community groups of creating a blizzard of hyperbolic allegations. According to a letter submitted by the City Deputy Corporate Counsel John Hendricks, allegations about negative environmental impacts of the additions and improvements to the facility are factually unfounded. According to Hendrickson, the site is 2,000 feet away from area residents, which is the equivalent of three city blocks. However, this has not eased the concerns of local residents, as large particles of dust known as particulate matter, or PM10, are known to travel from 100 feet to as far as 30 miles. Smaller particles, or PM25, are known to travel several hundred miles.
Particles between 2.5 and 10 microns are called coarse particulates, or PM10. These are of concern to human health as they are small enough to be inhaled and accumulate in the respiratory system. Particles of 2.5 microns or less are referred to as PM2.5 or fine particulates and are a greater health risk than PM10 as they can reach deeper into the lung. Children are especially susceptible to the effects of particulate matter as their respiratory systems are still developing. The elderly and adults with chronic heart or lung diseases are also more likely to experience the effects. However, healthy adults can also feel these effects from particulate matter. Fine particulates, as I mentioned before, can get deeper into the lungs and cause serious health problems, such as decreased lung function, aggravated asthma, development of respiratory disease in children, irregular heartbeat, non-fatal heart attacks, premature death in people with heart or lung disease, increased susceptibility to heart and vascular disease for postmenopausal women, and increased risk of lung cancer.
According to the EPA reports, the General Iron site in Lincoln Park would shred material that released volatile organic compounds, metal hazardous air pollutants, and particulate matter. These can include arsenic, cadmium, chromium, manganese, among others. In other city news, Chicago Public School CEO Janice Jackson announced early in the week that CPS schools will be reopening. According to news reports, Jackson and other school officials are convinced that reopening schools is safe and will begin bringing back high school students during the second semester. The plan calls for elementary school students to return on February 1st while only bringing back some high school students. CPS will first target under-enrolled schools for reopening. Parents were asked to decide whether to continue remote learning or choose an in-class option. Jackson stated that teachers will not have the same option. Representatives of Chicago's teachers union stated concern due to the health risks that are facing adult teachers, including those with underlying conditions. Teachers have further expressed concern over the additional workload of managing remote and in-class teaching sessions. Jackson has stated that teachers have been given notice to prepare for the changes and teachers need to attend in person and would be handled as employees being asked to attend a regular workday at the office. In national news, a federal judge has reinstated the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, better known as DACA. DACA was suspended following a July memo released by Trump appointee Chad Wolf. Wolf attempted to derail DACA by not allowing recipients to apply for renewals and denying new applications. DACA was a program instituted by the Obama administration that would allow young immigrants who were brought to the country as children to legally work and not face deportation. The program assists over 650,000 people. In November, courts ruled that Wolf was illegally appointed to the position by Trump and issuing orders in violation of U.S. law. In other national news, Trump attorney and former mayor of New York City, Rudy Giuliani, has tested positive for COVID-19. 76-year-old Giuliani is considered a high-risk patient due to his age and existing medical conditions. Giuliani has been acting as the lead for Trump's attempt to overturn the results of the 2020 election. Some news organizations have claimed that Giuliani has been attempting to receive a pardon from Trump before he leaves office. Although Giuliani is not currently under indictment for federal crimes, some Trump officials have been saying Trump should issue preemptive pardons for himself and his children as they fear indictments once Trump leaves office. However, a federal pardon will not impact current state cases that are pending against Trump or his elderly children, whose businesses are being investigated by several state attorney generals for fraud. In other local news, a new marijuana dispensary is set to open in River Oaks. Mission Dispensaries is opening up a new location on 1330 Torrance Avenue across the street from the shopping center. Reports state that the community responded positively to the development at a city town hall, and the site is targeting area residents, including those from Northwest Indiana. And finally, local area residents are beginning to take a stand against one of our area's most under-discussed issues of substance abuse and alcoholism. An estimated 88,000 people die in the U.S. annually from excessive alcohol consumption, and about 67,000 die a year from illicit drug and opioids. Local residents have joined with the National Phoenix Organization, whose mission is to build a sober, active community that fuels resilience and harnesses the transformational power of connection to help people join together to rise, recover, and live. More information can be found at the group's Facebook page at The Phoenix Chicago. And that ends our weekly review for November 30th through December 7th, 2020. Thank you for joining us for this week in review. Peace.
I swear when nobody's around, you'll keep my head around your neck. We connect. Are you feeling it now? Cause I am. I got so hotter than that. I swear to God, from my feet I lift the ground. Oh yeah. This is all we've been talking about in my head. Nothing feels better than this. Nothing feels better.